Friends, the Blessed Buddha once said, just as dawn is a forerunner and the precursor of the rising of the sun, exactly so is good and noble friendship. For any disciple, the forerunner and the precursor of the mental emergence of the seven links to awakening. When a disciple has a good and noble friend, it is to be expected that he will develop and cultivate these seven links to awakening. And how does a bhikkhu who has a good and noble friend develop and cultivate these seven links to awakening? Here, friends, this bhikkhu trains, develops, deepens, reinforces and refines the awareness linked to awakening, sati, sambhayanga, the investigation linked to awakening, dhamma vichaya, sambhayanga, the energy linked to awakening, virya, sambhayanga, the joy linked to awakening, piti, sambhayanga, the tranquility linked to awakening, prasadi, sambhayanga, the concentration linked to awakening, samadhi, sambhayanga, the equanimity linked to awakening, upekkha, sambhayanga. While based upon seclusion, disillusion, ceasing of craving, and culminating in release, it is exactly this very way that any bhikkhu who has a good and noble friend truly trains, grows, intensifies, reinforces and refines these seven links to awakening. These seven links are inclining, sloping and falling towards enlightenment. The Blessed Buddha once said, bhikkhus, just as all the rafters in a peak house slant, slope, tilt, tend, incline and veer towards the roof peak, even so when a bhikkhu begin to develop the seven links to awakening, then he indeed slants, slopes, tilts, tends, inclines, and veers towards nibbana. Why and how is this convergence so? When, friends, a bhikkhu trains, develops, expands, consolidates and refines the awareness linked to awakening, the investigation linked to awakening, the energy linked to awakening, the joy linked to awakening, the tranquility linked to awakening, the concentration linked to awakening, and the equanimity linked to awakening. While based upon seclusion, dissolution and ceasing, maturing and culminating in release, then these seven links to awakening and the repeated training of them in and by themselves make him slant, slope, tilt, tend, veer and incline towards nibbana. Venerable Sai Buddha once said, friends, friend, because replied. Venerable Sai Buddha then explained this. Friends, there are these seven links to awakening. What seven? 1. The awareness linked to awakening, sati sambhayanga. 2. The investigation linked to awakening, dhamma vichaya sambhayanga. 3. The energy linked to awakening, virya sambhayanga. 4. The joy linked to awakening, piti sambhayanga. 5. The tranquility linked to awakening, prasadi sambhayanga. 6. The concentration linked to awakening, samadhi sambhayanga. And 7. The equanimity linked to awakening, Upekka Sampuyanga. These are the seven links to awakening. In which shape of these seven links to awakening I wish to dwell in the morning, in that I abide in the morning. In whichever I wish to dwell at noon, in that I abide at noon. In whichever I wish to dwell in the evening, in that I abide in the evening. Suppose a king or a minister had a cupboard full of clothes of many various colors. Then whichever pair of clothes he wished to put on in the morning, that he would put on in the morning. And whichever clothes he wished to put on at noon, that he would put on at noon. And whichever clothes he wished to put on in the evening, that he would put on the evening. So too, in whichever of these seven links to awakening I wish to abide in for whatever period, in that indeed I easily abide, dwelling fully absorbed into that aspect. If it occurs to me that now there is the awareness link to awakening present in me, then it occurs to me that it is measureless, and it occurs to me that it is well established. And while it is remaining, I know that it remains. And if it falls away in me, then I know instantly that it faded away, caused by this or that specific condition. So too with the other six links to awakening. I notice both their presence, ceasing, and absence. It's from the group sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, book 46 on the links. And the suttas was the 48, the sun, 7, the peaked house, and 4, the clothes. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 84, recorded on the 8th December 2017 on planet Earth, on Sri Lanka, on Nuggets Mountain, under the Cypress tree. There are three questions, one Dhammasala report, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was Cypress Buddha, indeed. First off the bat, remember to click subscribe down there and the small bell down there, so you're notified about any new videos that are uploaded. Why so? Because subscribing to this channel, this Dhamma channel, is really your ticket to Nibbana. Don't lose it by negligence, neglect, or other circumstances. So this is important. Why is it your ticket to Nibbana? Because it ensures that you will, for the next 17 years at least, be reminded and reminded and reminded time and time over again about the Dhamma. And thereby gradually your life and thought world and views and activities will be aligned with and pointed towards and leveled with the Noble Eightfold Way going to Nirvana. So by subscribing, you will come to automatically incline towards, slope towards, glide towards, drift towards Nibbana, the deathless element. So those small things, just click subscribe. It is fairly significant. And so is it with essential things. Because of this unlinearity in nature, sometimes very important things, they look insignificant. And sometimes very insignificant things, they look big and pompous, but they are inessential. Empty glitter, you could say. As you noted in the intros I give into these videos at the moment, then I'm trawling in the land of the seven links to enlightenment, the Sambhuyangas. And this is a part of a long-term plan to enunciate, to explain the 37 states producing enlightenment, the 37 Bodhipakkhiya Dhammas, of which the seven links to enlightenment, the seven factors of enlightenment, the Bhuyangas, are a part. So I will go through the Bhuyangas first generally with a series of intros, and then there will come first one, some number on the first Bhuyanga, namely Sati, awareness, and then investigation, Dhamma Vichaya, and so forth. It will come in series after. So we've gone through all the seven factors of enlightenment, both in general, as the intro to this video was, and then also specifically, each factor have one of several intros for itself. The meditation hall, it's turned nice weather actually. Today is extremely nice weather, despite the December month. So we are planning to carry up sand. As we speak here, the sand should be trucked up the mountain from the nearest hardware, loaded in bags, and then they will begin to offload it today and begin to carry it up tomorrow. So I think in 2 weeks' time we can make the last wall, the middle wall of the foundation of the meditation hall, the Bhavana Sala. Thanks to the supporters, both before and now and recently, who have significantly contributed to this noble and worthy project. May much merit and elevation, both in understanding, in insight, and in calm, be theirs. And the meditation construction hall report comes right here.
Just a little update on the meditation hall. As you see, we have built four walls now. All the four walls are built. We need to set scaffolding up in the middle, and then we need to bend the iron for the fifth wall. It should go down the middle here. Down here, from here all to the next here. And there the two middle pillars will stand. Then this whole area will be filled up with stones. Major job, and earth, and then we'll make the floor here. As this is partly filled up, we'll start to make the pillars, cement pillars there. But serious rain up here in December month, so it's a little difficult to get the sand up here. There's a limit to the number of days we can carry it up, but it goes little by little. Fourth wall finish. Thank you for the support, and have a nice and noble day here from Knuckles Mountain, which is up there, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Thank you.
Yes, friends, remembering death and what is on the other side of this crucial event is often useful when enhancing one's altruistic activities. For the Buddha said, on the other side of death is only what we did on this side of death, what we did in this life and in our prayer lives, and whatever support that of probability, uplifting support of probability, that is basically our good doing to others and to the world in general, that is our altruistic activities. Minus, subtracted, whatever evil, detrimental, wrong we did in this life and in all our past lives. So it's worth noticing that this is the only support, the Buddha said, for beings is their good karma. Here in Sri Lanka called pin karma. When you go into temples, you will often see people cleaning, voluntarily cleaning the floor, or grooming or ordering the flowers. So here's a very acute understanding of the necessity of doing something good for others. Whether it's donating to a meditation hall or to a Dhamma book being published or to Dhamma videos being published, anything that help other beings approach Nibbana, approach peace, approach lasting happiness, that will increase one's own probability and ability to approach Nibbana and thereby reach the end of suffering. So creating opportunities for others creates opportunities for oneself. Thank you. Actually, when working myself on this project of building a meditation hall, I feel a great satisfaction because I know I do something good for others. And when you do something altruistic, then you also feel a great satisfaction. You are like lighted up by an inner fire and become very happy and satisfied by doing this good. Knowing that many of the donors and many others also, of course, will come and meditate in this meditation hall for the next 20 years, this makes me very happy. So they can approach Nibbana, they can become more free, more happy, more peaceful, and have a greater insight into the absolute nature of reality.
So much for meditation hall constructions, which makes me more and more happy to do this good for everyone. And I think this will come a lot of good Dhamma out of this meditation hall. A lot of visitors, more and more visitors come here, and instead of talking to them only blah blah about insight, then we can also do some praxis actually. Sit down and meditate for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 45 minutes, and eventually for 8 hours a day, 8 hours or 10 hours a day on the long run. But now the questions. Question 250. When to do Vipassana Insight and when to do Samatha Calm doing Anapana-sati breathing meditation? Should one do Insight first and then Calm afterwards, or first Calm and then Insight? That's basically the question. And it's true that there are people who progress along the way primarily first by attaining Calm and then Insight. And then there's some who do the opposite. They are basically the meditators who first develop Calm and then Insight. Then there are those who do the other way around. They are usually philosophers who like to intellectualize, say, do first insight and then attain some level of calm. And then there are some who goes with calm and insight hand in hand. That's the best way, actually. And this is what my answer is going upon. Doing Anapanasati meditation, you can do insight and note the three universal characteristics of impermanence, suffering, and no self in all stages. If we just take the breath itself, breathing in, one can note how short the breath in is and how it's gone, never to come back. That's impermanence. One can see that it's easily see that it's very painful to sit there on this pillow. Usually people are very aversive to it and cannot sit long on this pillow. So they think it is hard to meditate, actually. That's suffering aspect. And then if one sees that there's no breather, there's no only the activity of breathing in and breathing out. It's not a me, a I, a myself, or a my body who breathe in or breathe out. It's the process of breathing itself. Then one sees the no self aspect. So one can do insight in all situations. One can do insight. And similarly, one can do calm in all situations also. Right now, let's do one breath, noting the touch of air in your nostrils. One breath, deep, slow, and fine. and calm is right there. So both calm and insight, they should go hand in hand. And in all situations, whether doing Anapanasana meditation, standing in the queue in the supermarket, at the workplace, in the family, when going down to sleep at the pillow, when brushing teeth, and so forth. Calm and insight. Samatha Vipassana. We'll go through in detail what, in the ultimate sense, what this calm and insight is. Calm is just seen a little up front. Calm is a stepping stone. It's means to an end. It's a tool to achieve something else, namely insight. Because it is insight that liberates, that releases. Insight into this nama rupa, this minding and mattering, this naming and forming, this mentality and materiality, whether internal, external, past, present, and future, that all this is transient, impermanence, evaporating, evanescent, and therefore not trustable, miserable, suffering, disappointing, frustrating, and therefore, ultimately speaking, also no self, not me, not mine, not what I am, not myself, not an ego, not a soul. In the deepest sense, this is what sets free. Because then one stops the craving for this internal stream of mentality and materiality, and this external stream of materiality and mentality. Whether alive or dead, whether animate or inanimate, one doesn't crave for it. One has seen it in advance. If I jump this hook, then I'll have more suffering, more aging, sickness and death, more rebirth, and more cycles of this aging, sickness and death again. So one doesn't jump this hook. So calm is a tool to get the power and the concentration and the non-distraction to see, to drill through, to focus upon, to burn through like a burning glass with intense focus on the same object, then seeing it as it really is. So calm is a tool to get insight. And insight is what releases. Calm is Sammasamadhi in the ultimate sense. And the Buddha explained the fourfold definition of right concentration, Samma Samadhi, right concentration, the eighth factor of the Noble Eightfold Way, like this. Having eliminated the five mental hindrances, these mental defects that obstruct understanding, while quite secluded from sensual pleasures, protected from any detrimental mental states, one enters and dwells, remains in the first jhana, full of joy and pleasure born of solitude, joined with directed and sustained thought. One makes this joy and pleasure born of seclusion drench, saturate, soak and suffuse the entire body, so that no part of this entire body is unperfused by this intense joy and pleasure. Just as a skilled bathman puts soap powder in a copper basin and sprinkling it gradually with water, whips it until the water soaks and pervades all the soap powder, yet without dripping, so too does a noble friend make the joy and pleasure born of solitude permeate and pervade the entire body, as filled up with foam of joy and pleasure. Again, friends, with the stilling of directed and sustained thought, with absence, silencing of all thinking, one enters and dwells in the second jhana, a calm assurance of unification of mind, with even deeper joy and pleasure, now born of concentration, devoid of any thought, empty of any thinking. One makes this exquisite joy and pleasure born of concentration drench, saturate, soak and suffuse this entire body. So no part of the whole body is unperfused by this profound joy and pleasure. Just as a lake, whose waters welled up from below within itself and had no other sources, neither by showers of rain, then this cool fount of water welling up from deep within the lake itself would immerse, fill and pervade the entire lake. Even exactly so does one make this joy and pleasure born of concentration infuse this entire body. Like cool water welling up from a deep pool within the lake itself. Furthermore, friends, with the fading away of the joy, the friend dwells in equanimity, even just aware and clearly comprehending. Still feeling pleasure in the body, one enters upon and remains in the third jhana, regarding which the noble ones declare. In aware equanimity, one dwells in pleasure. One makes pleasure apart from joy, flood, saturate, soak, and suffuse the body, so there's no part of one's whole body unperfused by this pleasure and happiness, divested of joy. Just as a lotus pond, some lotuses are grown, grow and thrive immersed under the water, and the cool water soaks them from the roots to the tip, so too does the noble friend make the pleasure divested of joy drench, fill, flood and pervade this entire body. Finally, friends, with the leaving behind of both pleasure and pain, and with the prior disappearance of both joy and sorrow, both gladness and sadness, one enters and dwells in the fourth jhana, a completely stilled mental state of pure awareness, purified by equanimity, of neither pain nor pleasure. One sits illuminating this entire body with this pure, bright mind. So there's no part of one's whole body not illuminated, shined upon by this pure, bright mind. Just as a man was sitting covered from the head down with white cloth so that no part of his whole body was uncovered by this white textile, even so does one sit encompassing this entire body with a pure, bright and radiant mind. So there's no part of one's whole body not illuminated by this pure, bright, and luminous mind. Fourth jhana. Anything up to that, momentary concentration, kanika samadhi, upachara samadhi, neighborhood concentration, in approaching in the neighborhood of it, close to it, but not fully absorbed into it, that will also do. It is there within this very focused state of mind that is still purified, bright, that the drilling, the breakthrough to the inside comes. There's 18 major principle insight, Maha Vipassana, that releases and sets free and gives access to enlightenment or produces enlightenment or induces enlightenment because of this release. These 18 principal insights, Mahavipassana, is the following. Reflection on impermanence leaves the illusion of permanence. 2. Reflection on suffering renounces the misapprehension of pleasure. Reflection on no self evaporates the imagination of a myself. Reflection on dispassion and disillusion abandons naive delight. Reflection on disgust eradicates voracious and insatiable greed. Reflection on ceasing desists from blind initiating origination. Don't start something, you end something. Reflection on relinquishment releases the lock of grasped clinging. Reflection on fragility leaves the misconception of compact solidity. Reflection on the breakup of all constructions, shutdowns, accumulation. Reflection on change corrects the deception of any long-lasting constancy. Reflection on the signless eliminates the captivating appearance of a sign or a symbol. All these appearances, empty appearances. Reflection on the desireless diminishes the feverish urge of all craving. What's the point of wanting it if it's suffering anyway? Reflection on voidness erases the insistence on the self-deception. I am. I exist. My ego is in existence. Reflection on higher understanding uproots clinging to the fixed idea of a core. Reflection on direct knowledge and vision removes confused misinterpretation. Reflection on danger, adinava, extirpates false assumption of reliance on the unstable. I was okay yesterday, so I'll also be okay today and tomorrow and forever. So reliance, false reliance on what is unsafe. Reflection on resolute contemplation shelves the neglect of non-contemplation. Complacency. 18. Reflection on turning away. Exterminate mistaken insistence on self-bondage. Self-bondage. I have to be. I have to do this and that. I have to become this and that. Then this has to be cut out, because otherwise freedom cannot be attained, of course, if there's a necessity, have to do this and that. So this is basically insight, canon insight, in a nutshell. It's a gradual process, both canon and insight, and it goes hand in hand, because the more insight you get, the more motivated you will be to do more meditation. The more meditation you do, the more insight you will get. So it's a slowly turning away from all worldly, empty, worldly pursuits of vanity and pride and self-gratification. It's turning away from that through insight that makes one hit the pillow and do the job. It releases beyond description. But it takes, because one has habitually been reborn and falling in love with this self, and then done a good job of self-gratifying this, feeding this imaginary self pleasure and pride and insisting on this and that and planning this and that, then it's habitually difficult to give up this world, to give up this self, to give up this body, to give up this existence with a higher low. It is difficult, but it's not impossible. And that's the job, to release what is suffering. And all in samsara is suffering, whether internal, external, past, present, or future, whether gross or subtle, whether fine or foul, whether inferior or superior, whether far or near. It is all, and was always, only suffering. This is the first noble truth. This and such is suffering, dukkha. First noble truth. So much for calm and insight. Question 251. What to do if one thinks one is a future Buddha Metteyya? And is this usual? Yes, this is fairly usual, actually. Why so? Because Buddha Metteyya is kind of like a superhero in Buddhism, and this also goes for all the next Buddhas. Huh? So, and superhero syndrome is very common among human beings, and therefore Metteyya, probably Buddha Metteyya, Bodhisattva, this is fairly common among Buddhists, and this is slightly childish, but nevertheless, all superhero assumptions and dreaming and imaginations and fantasies, they are of course a form of self-gratification, an ego-aggrandizement, where one thinks there is a self, and then one wants to make this self better, and then say, oh, maybe I'm not Superman, I'm not Metteyya now, I'm not a Buddha now, or I'm not a superhero now, but I will be in the future. I will be a pop star. I will be a superhero. I will be a Buddha, a future Buddha. How to cure it? Well, one should stop it right there and see when these dreams comes up, see it as they are. It is these childish dreams. It is these childish dreams of superhero syndrome. Because there's no signs of one being a superhero. And one cannot even reach up to it. It one looks at one's own behavior. Then one has not superhero behavior. So it's not immediately logical why one should become a superhero in the future. I would say to generally a bodhisattva in particular, Metteyya, they usually go forth fairly early in life. So one is, if one is a layman and then think in the middle of one's life that one should be the future Buddha Metteyya, then one can ask oneself, why is it that I have not gone forth 10 years ago? Why is it that I have no plan of going forth into monkhood or leave the world right now? And then one will learn something about one's clinging. And also one can see, exclude that one is the Bodhisattva Metteyya, because one has not gone forth. One is still engaged in lay life, job, family, and so on. So it's a kind of like dreaming about the future. In this regard, I will just mention a deva once asked the Buddha from the Samyutta Nikaya, the first book, where there's a lot of conversation between devas and devatas, divine males and females, who comes at night and asks the Buddha various questions. And this is this question, it goes like this: why is your forest monks, Venerable Sir, looking so serene? And then the Buddha, he answered, they never lament over the past. Neither do they yearn for any future that has yet to come. They just maintain themselves in the present, here and now. Therefore, this appearance so serene. So this goes both for nostalgia, when you are looking back at a past time of glory, or good old days, or something like that, or similarly, when daydreaming about some glorious future with yourself being in some kind of superhero role. Usually one will put in the superhero role, one respects oneself. If one is a Buddhist, one will put it in typically in a Buddha role. If one is a sportsman, then one will imagine oneself as the world record holder within this sports. And if one is a musician or likes music, then one will see one as a pop star or best musician within this class of music. So it has something to do with one's own likes and dislikes, daydreaming, and then this self-ego-aggrandizement, which is based on the assumption and also the conviction that there is a self in the first place that can't be aggrandized and one day will be a superhero, which is not the case. There is no self. There was no self. There will be no self. Never have been, never will be. While one is either engaged in nostalgia or in daydreaming, then one completely loses focus on the present. And there, since the present is the only thing that is real and effective that produces future, then what's going on in the present is there but uncontrolled by this nostalgia, melancholia, and future daydreaming activities. So come back to the present here. Now it's here, the ball game goes on. This is the real deal, not any kind of fantasy or any kind of longing back is here, right here, right now. When one sees us to the full extent, this is right here, right now, becomes magical and fantastic, and one gets an acute awareness of it and of its efficacy and importance. It is here as the creation goes on. It is here mind makes future matter, future states. It's here mind make future mental states, whether happy or unhappy. So come back to here. Stop daydreaming. Stop longing back. Come back to here, here and now. What's mind doing? What's the body doing? What's going on? That's important. Here and now, present awareness, a factor of sati. Then there's this noble disciple. He also sees that these five clusters of clinging, this clinging to form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, he sees that whatever form there is, whether internal form or external form, whether past, present, or future, whether high or low, whether ugly or beautiful, whether subtle or gross, whether inferior or superior, whether far or near, whether in time or space, then all this is not me, it's not mine, it's not what I am, it's not myself. So, whatever form there is, whatever feeling there is, whatever perception there is, whatever experience there is, whatever mental construction there is, and whatever consciousness there is, then this is not me, mine, myself, what I am. If this is the case, then it's irrelevant what it was before, was imagined to be before, and what it's imagined to be in any future, inclusive whether it will be the individuality called Buddha Metteyya. Because it's not a self, it's not an identity. That refocuses also back to inside. Inside about the anatta, no self aspect of early Buddhism, which releases mind from this ego clinging, clinging to form, clinging to feeling, clinging to perception, clinging to mental construction, and clinging to consciousness, saying, ah, this is me, this is mine, this is what I am, this is myself. And this self will be like this and that in the future. And it was like this and that in the past. Forget it. Not relevant. Irrelevant. And also illusory. And imagination. There is no I. Never was, never will be. So, this releases from all this daydreaming. When one sees that there is only this process, ever ongoing process of nama rupa, of minding and mattering, of mentality and materiality, without any identity, without any core. The eagle that grieves. So much for this question. Question 252. Can a Bodhisattva, a Buddha-to-be being, renounce his determination to become a Buddha midways? And then say, ah, now I will be an Arahant instead of not a Samasambuddha. No, this has never occurred. Never occurred. So if one is thinking along these lines, then one is obviously not a Bodhisattva. And this one should just follow up on reaching awakening, because it's the same Nibbana, whether you're Samasambuddha, Pachika Buddha, or Savaka Buddha, a disciple, awakened being. So in the end goal is the same. So no Bodhisattva have ever given up. So this means that there are, if this 10 circumstances that the Bodhisattva goes forth under and makes his determination his first wish, then it is effective. It will never not be fulfilled. There might go many lives and so on, and the individual may not be fully aware of his own bodhisattvahood in all circumstances, but he will be retold and retold. Buddha Gautama, he was told by 24 other Buddhas, that he was going to be a Buddha. The first Buddha was Dipankara, and the last was Kassapa, who told him that he would be a Buddha in the future. So it happens because of these circumstances that has been formed over these immense long periods of time, many universal cycles. They produces this being, this state of Sammasambodhi, perfect self-enlightenment. And this cannot be abrogated whether the individual wants it or not. The Buddha, he explained it like this, and this also goes for normal awakened Savaka Buddhists who awakens as a disciple under another Buddha. It is like this, he said, if there is a hen and she doesn't lay her eggs, whether she wants it or not, then the eggs won't hatch. And this is because she's not laying on the eggs, protecting them with and heating them up. So it's irrelevant whether she wants or not to become keep chickens out of the eggs, because they won't hatch. And in the other case, the disciple, the noble disciple, who lays on the eggs and do the training, then it's like the hen that protects the eggs and produce heat, then the eggs will hatch. And so the noble disciple also will become enlightened, whether he likes it or not, whether he wants it or not. And the Buddha will also become a Sammasambuddha, whether he wants it or not, or like it or not. Because the circumstances, laying on the eggs, protecting them, heating them, over time, produces breakthrough to enlightenment. So much for today. Thanks for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas, the supporters and the donors, especially the food givers, the regular donors, and the meditation hall supporters. Thank you. May much merit elevating probability be theirs into an immense future. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you. And have a nice and noble day.
How is a bhikkhu moderating eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally eat food. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.
Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.